And good evening to all of you, and sorry I was a little late. I told Gayatri that I was coming from Lucknow, and my flight was delayed both ways. But we're also facing the usual budget, revised estimate crunch, so a little bit of running around. And the traffic is quite bad outside this circle. But thanks again for inviting me, Gayatri. Now, from what I heard, Gayatri told me this has focused a lot on what you're calling evidence-based policies for rural transformation. And in many ways, the program I'm going to talk about, which is the Swachh Bharat Mission Grameen, really turned out to be, as it happened, a kind of a mass movement at the grassroots level. And in that, everyone got caught up, whether it was self-help groups, the Jivika Didis from Bihar, or the self-help groups from other states. Everyone kind of got swept up in this social revolution, if you like, and it truly became what the Prime Minister has called many times a Jan Andolan, a people's movement. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that, and also talk about how this program went much beyond the building and the usage of toilets, and how it essentially became an empowerment program, particularly for women, and how it led to employment, it led to leadership roles, and how many of the quote-unquote beneficiaries essentially got into leadership roles and positions of influence in their communities. So, I mean, these are all, in many ways, not the original objectives of the program, but the ripple effect, the whatever you want to call it, the positive externality. I mean, it's had all kinds of other impacts, but I'm going to focus a little bit on the program and how it was done at scale. So we did scale in a decentralized manner, and I think those are some of the important lessons we have learned, which we are now applying to our next major program, which is called the Jal Jeevan Mission, which the Prime Minister announced in his first Independence Day speech of his second term, which is providing tap water to about 150 million rural households in 5 years. So another major objective set by the Prime Minister. Now, a little bit of background about this program. When we started this program, announced by the Prime Minister, 15th August 2014, many of you would remember, I was actually in Vietnam at the time, and in the bank in Hanoi, and my wife and I were watching television to hear what the Prime Minister had to say in his first speech. And now I've timed it, so for like 45 minutes into his speech, he was talking about dignity of women and girls, toilets, you know, and this is from the Red Fort, so which no one had ever done before. I thought that was very, very huge. And I remember telling my wife, you know, I've got to get back and be part of this program. And I was very lucky about 15 months later to come back as secretary of the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, which was essentially managing this program. Now, what were the challenges we faced when we first came in? The first, and you know, we like to, we've come up with a lot of acronyms. So we spoke of the four S's. And the first S was scale. So there were 600 million people in India who were practicing open defecation. This was 60% of the total of the world's open defecators, if there's a term like that. So there were 1 billion people, but 60% were in India. And of that 60%, of that 600 million odd, 550 were in rural India. So a huge number, not much had happened over the last 70 years. There had been incremental efforts at dealing with rural sanitation. But this was the first time it was being kind of tackled head on. So scale and then speed, because we had a five-year window. And I think as it turned out, it was just right. You know, someone called it the Goldilocks approach. Not too hot, not too cold. It was just enough. At that time, everyone thought it was impossible. You know, it hasn't been done for a million years. Why would it happen now? But that was a challenge. So second S was speed. The third S was stigma. And the practice of open defecation, you know, had been going on for centuries in India. And no one really thought there was a problem, except perhaps women and girls. And so if you've seen the movie, Toilet Ek Prem Katha, you will see how the whole idea of having a toilet inside the house is seen as a bad thing, impurity and stuff like that. So we have to deal with that, and that's the whole story of behavior change. And the fourth S is sustainability. How do we make the whole thing stick? You can achieve this in previous programs. In particular, we heard that dreaded term called slip back. And so people were using toilets, and then either the toilets went out of use, and then they went back to the bad old practice of open defecation. So we had to deal with these four S's. And how did we deal with them? Let me very briefly tell you. And that's, I think, where the whole the grassroots story begins. So for scale, we realized very quickly that, in fact, the only way you can deal with scale, particularly in India, a federal country, huge diversity, one size does not fit all, is to deal with it with scale itself. So we needed numbers on the ground. And then we set about creating this army of, there were two things we did. The first was to leverage school children. So there are, someone calculated about 120, 130 million school kids in India of that of an age which can actually help. And so school kids became our ambassadors. We reached out to them centrally, but mainly locally. And we got, in particular, the girls interested in this program. So for example, in East Champaran, where Gandhiji started the Indigo movement, we had girls out in that district, school girls coming out and saying, "Mujhe shauchale chahiye." So they went out and demanded it. They went out on the streets and they got them at home, they got them in the schools. So that was one army we used. The other army was perhaps the most significant army, the army of Swachhagrahis. So these Swachhagrahis, again, the name given by the Prime Minister. So from Satyagraha, the power of truth, to Swachhagraha, the power of Swachhata. And we realized that it became very, very important. So in fact, it's an interesting story which I'll share with you. Look, we have a lot of critics, right? We have a lot of critics today. We had critics earlier. Many people don't believe this, and they said the whole story is fake, and et cetera, et cetera. And so I had reached out to, I won't mention his name. There's a very prominent journalist who was writing against this program, and I joined in March 2016. So I said, let me go and meet this gentleman and ask him, give us some advice. Tell us, how can we improve this program? And so he said, this whole behavior change story you guys keep spinning, what does it really mean? And how do you do it? It's not credible. So then I told him that what we are trying to do, and this was based on feedback from actually some self-help groups, some ladies who had been working as ASHA workers, Anganwadi workers, when we went out in the field. And they said that we need to have, in every village in India, there are 6 lakh villages. It would be good to have one person, a village motivator, who's trained in behavior change. And the kind of behavior change which we do in our sector has got different names. There's CLTS, all of you have heard about, community-led total sanitation. You know, gurus like Kamalkar and others have started this, and it's spread a lot. There's CATS, community approaches to total sanitation. So all this has been tried for a very long time. The question was, how do you do it at scale? So they said it would be good to have one village motivator, ideally in every village in India. So that's 6 lakh Swachhagrahis or village motivators. So when I discussed it with this gentleman, he said, that's a very powerful idea. If you can credibly have one person in every village in India, trained in behavior change, trained in triggering behavior change. The word triggering became very fashionable over the last 4 years. How you go there to a village, you do the social mapping a la Robert Chambers, you do the PRA stuff or whatever it's called now, and then you get people to understand the importance of sanitation, why it's important from a health point of view, from an economic point of view, from an environmental point of view. But if you have one person well-trained, that will make a huge difference. So we took that very seriously. And we went from, I think initially from 500 or 1,000 or 1,500 Swachhagrahis, today we have got more than 6 lakhs. And it's not exactly matching one Swachhagrahi per village, but this army, this is our real grassroots army. And again, we got a very good name from the Prime Minister. He said, let's call them Swachhagrahis. So these are the warriors of Swachhata. And so all of them were trained, most of them in a 5-day training session on community approaches to sanitation. So they went out there, they did the triggering. Today, they're helping us in sustaining all those games of sanitation, that the fourth S. So when we discussed this story, then it, this gentleman considered that this is a credible story. If you've got boots on the ground, you've got people who are trained in this, then we can say, okay, that interpersonal communication is taking place at scale. So that was the second thing. Then, of course, our sarpanches. We have got 2,250,000 sarpanches in India. They became army. Then we had 700 collectors. We had brand ambassadors. And of course, we were very fortunate, I have to say, to have one communicator in chief who was the prime minister. So, you know, we had a million events with the prime minister. He was our biggest brand ambassador. It gave us huge political mileage, or leverage, I should say. So that was how we dealt with scale. But again, when it came to speed, the second S, in the end, you know, I've said this many times and many of you would have heard it. It was that old tried and tested formula, which I'm from the UP cadre of the IAS, and we use this a lot, that there are only three important jobs in India: PM, CM, and DM. And in a federal system, we had to apply that formula. Made a huge difference, of course. A flagship program of the Prime Minister, there was political alignment for the most part. Even in states which did not have the ruling party running the state, every state was interested in this program. You know, we went out there, we were traveling salesmen, we went and met them. So all of us, I must have traveled about 250 times in the last almost 4 years. So we went out, we reached out to states, and they understood the importance. So how did we get our program on the top of their agenda? So was it in the top five of the chief secretary's programs? Was it in the top three of the collector's program? So we were fighting for that space at the district level, and usually we got it. So that also made a big difference. Now, involving everyone in the district. So you take Bihar, for example, and I'm sure many of you are from there or you know about. So in Bihar, the didis were leading this program, the Jivika didis. And they themselves, they did, many of them were Swachhagrahis also, because it's an honorary position. They get, you get a token, you get an incentive, but it's not a permanent job. So how did we get convergence at the district level? All the district machinery, whether they were self-help groups or others, the Asha worker, the Anganwadi worker, all of them was kind of swept into this program, and they all got involved. And there was a sense of excitement. So I think the other thing we did was, there was a sense of excitement about this program. It wasn't just another job, it wasn't a Sarkari job. People felt involved, they felt part of this revolution, and it's got very high, I don't know what the technical term for it is, brand recognition. So everyone had heard of Swachh Bharat, whether it was because of the sort of mass media we did, but everyone was talking about it. The Swachh Bharat Chashma is on our currency notes, which is a brilliant marketing tool for the program. So I think there's a recall of, if that's the term, of 3,000 for every person in rural India. Everyone heard about this program and they wanted to be a part of it. And then of course the stigma part, the behavior change itself was partly addressed through this interpersonal communication with the Swachhagrahis, but also we had all our brand ambassadors. We had Akshay Kumar's Toilet Ek Prem Katha, which was a very good communication tool. Then we had this program where the bank helped us a lot on, which was the Darwaza Band program, where we had Amitabh Bachchan telling people to shut the door, Darwaza Band on open defecation. And then the sequel to that was on sustaining it. He did another series for us where he was appealing for everyone to keep using that toilet, because this program, ultimately, it's about usage of toilets, not construction. And the tagline for that was Har Koi, Har Roz, Hamesha. And we ran that program, and we're still running that program. So I think that was how we dealt with, and then of course, finally, people's, the fourth S, sustainability, which we're focused on today. It's not mission accomplished, never will be. There will be gaps, there are gaps, there are new people coming in. And so we're very conscious of the fact that the work on sanitation just has to keep going on. And we're moving now from ODF to ODF Plus, which is focusing on general swachhata, solid liquid waste management in the village. But let me just tell you a little bit again about, a little bit more about some specific instances of how rural livelihood, if you like, got actually integrated fairly seamlessly with our own program. So in the state of Jharkhand, is anyone here from Jharkhand? Jharkhand? Okay, so Jharkhand had this fabulous initiative which came out of Swachh Bharat. called Rani Mistris. So as all of you would know, Raj Mistri is a mason in Hindi. And so they came up with this term called Rani Mistri. So they developed a cadre of Rani Mistris. And this very interesting stories how in villages where which were becoming open defecation free, and let's say there was a village of 200 households, and so these toilets needed to be built. So a group of women suddenly decided, why can't we not just get toilets, why can't we build them? And so they started getting trained in masonry. It's not all that complicated. You know, these are simple twin pit toilets. And so they actually initially, if you hear some of these stories, families resisted it. They said, you know, we can't go out and work as a mason. But they went out, and now there are some 50,000 odd women masons in Jharkhand, and it's spreading. So it led to employment, if you like, and now they have gone from toilets to houses. Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, which maybe they are building houses now. So they have actually upgraded their skills. Then the Didis in Bihar, they played a major role in this behavior change. And I'm sure all of you know Bala and Arvind Chaudhary, those guys have done a fabulous job. And so they brought in that whole cadre of what, 80 lakhs, I forget the number. So all of them got involved. So it became a situation where people from other departments actually got involved. And many of them also earned a little bit of money from this, because they were getting, we were giving out incentives for villages which became ODF. There was an incentive for toilets being built. So it led to a generation of fairly decent, for that period, employment opportunities. In fact, UNICEF has done a study for us, a kind of macroeconomic study, and they found that about 75 lakh equivalent jobs have been created out of Swachh Bharat. And a lot of these have been women in rural areas. Now, so that's the sense of how the Swachh Bharat mission went beyond this behavior change and led to sort of wider opportunities. Now, the other thing which Gayatri gave me some feedback is some of the issues which perhaps you have been discussing today is the difficulties and challenges of monitoring and measuring progress. You know, I understood that perhaps came up for discussion. Now, in our program, we understood very early, so we have got a whole series of acronyms, but it's very important in any implementation program, particularly at scale, when it's decentralized to such an extent, is to make sure that you're on the right track, you're learning from what you're doing, and you're evaluating. And in all the sort of complicated discussions on monitoring and evaluation and going short term, medium term, long term, going from outputs, outcomes, results, impact, we can have all that discussion. But we decided early in this program that we need to have two kinds of credible evaluation done externally. Because the kind of claims we were making, no one actually believed. And sometimes we didn't believe it ourselves because we've got a fairly robust MIS. But the question was, okay, you say you've built all these toilets, how do you know they exist? And how do you know people are using them, right? This is a basic question which people ask me even today. Now, first of all, so we used technology, and we have geotagged, I think, over 90% of these toilets. So more than 105 million toilets have been built after 2nd October 2014. So there's some evidence of that. And we have a process of verification. So when a village self-declares itself as ODF, there's an external agency which comes and verifies that. And there are two levels of verification. There's V1 and V2. That's the process itself. And then we do an annual, national annual rural sanitation survey, which is actually under the World Bank support project, where we go to a huge sample size, over 90,000 households, 6,000 villages all across the country. And we have just completed the third one. This is done by an independent verification agency. And we have an expert working group headed by two of the most reputed statisticians, economists in India. You've probably heard of both of them. So one of them is Professor Amitabh Kundu, and the other one is Dr. N.C. Saxena. And I think both of them are pretty tough on us. These are not people who are going to sign off on whatever the agency produces. We have the bank, we have UNICEF, Gates, we have WaterAid, we have the Ministry of Statistics. So it's important to have a credible oversight agency, and they oversee the results, and then they finally sign off on them. So I think that became very important. But then we also did external evaluations. So we had UNICEF, the bank did a study for us on the impact on gender. UNICEF has done a couple of studies for us on the economic impact of this program, the health impact, except the environmental impact. And now we're doing finally one on the macroeconomic impact. And two studies which are going to come out hopefully by March 8th, which might be of particular interest to you, the specific impact and on women. So the hypothesis is that the Swachh Bharat Mission has led to a significant reduction in the incidence of sexual crimes against women, because they don't need to go out early morning and late night in the dark. And so anecdotal evidence confirms this. We're doing a study on this with basically a field-based study. And the other one is on something which I think we will agree intuitively upon, is that a reduction in the dropout rate of girls from primary to secondary in particular. So we're doing these two studies. And if anyone has any ideas on this, or you know, you want to be part of it, let us know, because we're just starting these two studies. We are very confident that they will lead to positive results, but we'll see. So I think it's became very important to have others saying this. The World Health Organization did a study for us, which calculated that the Swachh Bharat Mission would have saved more than 3 lakh lives by the time it ended. The first phase ended in October 19. So basically, kids below the age of 5 who die of diarrhea, etc. So you know, this program would have probably saved a lot of lives as well. So I think it became important for that. We have learned a lot of lessons as we have done these studies. And I think it's important for any program to keep verifying, to keep learning. And we learned a lot, and we made a lot of mid-course corrections because of this. I've got a couple of other things to say, and which sort of, what are the bigger lessons of this program? And as we go forward, what's the plan for sustaining it, and what's the plan for drinking water, which is the next big mission? There were 4 big lessons we learned. Again, easy to remember because we call them the 4 P's. And the first P, we sometimes take for granted, which is political leadership. And the fact that we had the Prime Minister of India announcing this program from the Red Fort and then talking about it at all opportunities and giving us the kind of political support which actually we took for granted. But in many countries, you don't have that, and in many programs, you don't have that. So that made, I think that was a game-changing difference. The second P is public financing. And I think this, again, we sort of took for granted. What does it mean? Sanitation is a public good, because in a village, if half the houses have toilets and half don't, all those who have toilets, they're still not safe from the disease which comes when others defecate in the open, because the flies don't know, you know, they don't discriminate between houses. The contaminated water goes to everybody. So it's a public good, and it needs public financing. And therefore, this government decided to give an incentive of 12,000 rupees to every eligible person. That's a very big amount. And in this program, if you look at it in dollars, it's something above $20 billion were invested in this program over this 5-year period. It's more than 1 lakh crores, 1.2 lakh crores. Now, again, it shows that when a government makes a political commitment, it puts its money where its mouth is. So it actually put money behind this. One of the big challenges which I faced when I was in the bank, and all colleagues in the bank will probably agree, is that when I don't know, take rural livelihoods, for example, I'm now making this up. If you are engaging with your counterparts in the sector ministry, they've got a plan, they're interested in the subject, and they probably know how to set about it, and they need some funding. But the finance minister may not agree. So the finance minister, and that's part of the discussion why I got late, because you know, we are trying to get a little bit more budget for our program. They have got competing claims on their resources. So it became very important. One of our challenges was, it's not enough just to deal with the sector ministry. You've got to deal with the planning ministry and the finance ministry to convince them to invest in the sector, which we think is very important for many reasons. And here, we really never had to do that. But we had a fantastic backer of the program in Mr. Arun Jaitley, the late finance minister, who was totally convinced about this program. And if you see the graph of how our budget increased over 4 years, it's very interesting. So when I came in 14-15, our budget of my ministry for sanitation was, I think, 3,000 crores, about that. 15, 16, we got about 7,000 crores. The next year, it became 15. We finally got 30,000. So essentially, they looked at progress. It's important initially to have a kind of leap of faith. We need to invest in this sector, but you also need to deliver. And I think they got more confident about delivery as the program rolled on, and then they invested more and more in it. So that public financing is the second P, very, very important. Many of the other developing countries, particularly in Africa, there's going to be a summit in Addis in a couple of weeks, where the ministers and the finance ministers are very interested in learning about how the first two P's happened in India. And so we're going to try and share that story. The third P is partnerships. And I think we were very clear from the beginning that this cannot be a Sarkari program. It's partnership with development organizations, the bank, UNICEF, the Gates Foundation, WaterAid, but also NGOs at the national level, at the state level, at the local level, community-based organizations, sarpanches. This had to become a snowballing kind of social revolution. And we call that partnerships. And then, of course, the fourth was people's participation. The Jan Andolan, getting people excited. And all these lessons we are now trying to apply to the next major challenge. Because this government, you know, believes in last mile delivery. And, you know, whether it's toilets or cooking gas cylinders or bank accounts or houses, I think there's been very significant achievement in terms of delivery. But the one thing which hadn't been delivered was drinking water and taps in at home. And so the Prime Minister announced the Jal Jeevan Mission, Har Ghar Jal. And this program, today we have a coverage of about only 18%, 1/8, in terms of tap connections in rural households. There are about, 18 crore, 180 million rural households in India. So only about 3.6 crores or 36 million have tap connections today. So we've got to go from that 18% coverage to 100% in 5 years. A huge challenge, probably much more complex than sanitation. Although you don't need to worry too much about behavior change here because people would like to have clean water. Whereas in sanitation, we were trying to create demand for a product which there was no intrinsic demand for, mainly. So that was much more challenging, and the triggering became very important. But here, water conservation is important. So that's the behavior. So all these lessons, the PM is very keen that we, learning from Swachh Bharat and other programs, we really make it a people's movement. And so we are going to have, wherever there's groundwater available in a particular village, we will have small schemes. We'll have what are called SVS, single village schemes, which will be small schemes locally managed. And following that famous principle of subsidiarity, we'll have wherever you don't have it and it needs to be managed at a higher level, we'll have multi-village schemes. But essentially, it'll be managed at the lowest appropriate level. And again, we want people to take charge. They've got to pay for operation and maintenance. And so we're going to need a huge amount of support. And all this army of Swachhagrahis, all this sort of cross-sectoral groups at the grassroots, they're all going to kick in because they will be needed for this program as well. And this is another major program. So far, the Prime Minister announced 3.6 lakh crores. I don't know what that is, $60-70 billion, probably is going to be more. And so again, these four P's will apply. And all these lessons, again, this is going to be another grassroots, we are hoping, revolution for water over these 5 years. It'll also focus on water conservation, groundwater recharge, and reuse of grey water. So we are trying to have an end-to-end solution, not like in the old days where the drinking water people would only focus on the distribution system and not worry about the source or the recharge or the wastewater which comes out. So let me stop there. I don't know if I've told you adequately about the program, but I thought that's a good overview. I've got a short film which I wanted to show you, which is a story of Swachh Shakti, which is essentially how women took charge of this program. It's February 2019. So my team asked me to remind you that the numbers there are old numbers. So so it's not the 100% figure which we would have shown you later. Can we see the film? Every March 8th.
Rashtrapita Gandhi ji ne ek swachh aur sundar Bharat ka sapna dekha tha. 15 August 2014 को प्रधानमंत्री श्री नरेंद्र मोदी ने स्वच्छता के इस सपने को सच करने का बीड़ा उठाया। 5 वर्षों से भी कम समय में देश में आज स्वच्छता की धारा निर्बाध रूप से बह रही है, और जिस शक्ति ने पूरी लगन और मेहनत से समाज को बदलने का काम किया है, वो शक्ति है भारत की नारी शक्ति।
स्वच्छता और महिला सीधा सीधा संबंध है। हर प्रकार की स्वच्छता बनाए रखने में अगर सबसे ज्यादा किसी ने योगदान दिया है तो हमारे देश की नारी शक्ति ने दिया हुआ है।
झारखंड की इन रानी मिस्त्रियों ने स्वच्छ भारत की इस पुकार पर बदलाव का बीड़ा उठाया और निकल पड़ी अपने अपने घरों से देश की काया पलटने के लिए।
रानी मिस्त्री बनने के बाद मेरे बारे में ही सब जगह मान सम्मान हो रहा है, इसलिए मुझे चाहिए कि मैं दूसरा जिला में भी दीदी लोग को भी मेरे तरह ट्रेन करें।
इन्होंने साबित कर दिया है कि यदि आत्मबल हो तो सदियों से पुरुष प्रधान रहे क्षेत्रों में भी महिलाएं अपनी छाप छोड़ सकती है। जम्मू कश्मीर में बारामूला के एक गांव की सरपंच सुरैया जी और उनकी स्वच्छाग्रही साथी वो शक्ति हैं जो सभी को साथ लेकर आगे बढ़ी हैं।
मेरे गांव में हर घर में बैतुल खुला है, हर बच्चा, हर बुजुर्ग, हर औरत इसको इस्तेमाल भी कर सकते हैं। आज हमारा गांव सफाई में नंबर 1
है। ऐसी ही हजारों महिला सरपंचों की सरपरस्ती में अब हर घर हर गाँव चमचमा रहा है।
आज हर क्षेत्र में हर स्तर पर नारी शक्ति आज स्वच्छता की इस मशाल को थामे पूरे भारत का नेतृत्व कर रही है। स्वच्छ भारत की सफलता में महिलाओं का विशाल योगदान है और यह अभियान नारी स्वावलंबन और सशक्तिकरण का प्रतीक बन गया है।
नए भारत में हर नारी ने अपने सामर्थ्य अपनी शक्ति को पहचाना है। तमिलनाडु के शक्ति स्वयं सेवा समूह ने घर घर जाकर कूड़े कचरे को इकट्ठा करके जैविक खाद बनाई और कचरे से कमाई का उदाहरणीय चलन शुरू किया। कुंभ के मेले में स्वच्छता प्रबंधन में ये प्रशंसनीय योगदान दे रही है और स्वच्छता के इस जन आंदोलन में एक स्वच्छ शक्ति बन के उभरी है।
हम महिलाओं में वो शक्ति है, किसी भी चीज का रूप बदल सकते हैं। अगर मैं अपने गांव को स्वच्छ कर सकती हूँ, अपने ब्लॉक को स्वच्छ करती हूँ, अपने जिले को स्वच्छ कर सकती हूँ, तो मैं अपने भारत देश को भी स्वच्छ कर सकती हूँ।
स्वच्छ भारत अभियान के कारण महिला श्रमिक संख्या में वृद्धि हुई है, महिलाओं के स्वास्थ्य पर भी स्वच्छ भारत की प्रगति का सकारात्मक प्रभाव पड़ा है। दूसरी ओर भारत में ऐसी 2.25 लाख महिला स्वच्छाग्रही स्वच्छ भारत अभियान का नेतृत्व कर रही है। इस स्वच्छ शक्ति के बलबूते पर एक नए भारत का निर्माण हुआ है, एक स्वच्छ भारत का निर्माण हुआ है।
मंझधार सनैया तड़के लाए हैं, सूरज आंखों में भर के लाए हैं, डाल डाल पे नया सवेरा है, घर घर खुशियों का तेरा है, जो सबने ख्वाब में देखा था वो हमने